It's a real pleasure for me to welcome you to tonight's event on behalf of both the Department of Political Science and the International Relations Program. We're really thrilled and very grateful that you've carved out time and, or for sure, some very busy schedules to come out to campus for this event. Tonight's event is going to be an opportunity for all of us to learn about what is likely to be looked back on as one of the most consequential developments of the 21st century, and quite devastating development, Russia's war in Ukraine. The Mark Zacher Lecture is also an important part of our alumni program in the Department of Political Science and the IR program. It's a really important part of how we are working to build and nurture the broader UBC Political Science and IR communities. I'm just curious, out of curiosity, for how many of you is this the first political science or IR alumni event that you've been to? That's really fantastic. I'm really delighted to see so many people here tonight for the first time. We have an ever-expanding program set of events on our sort of annual calendar of alumni programs. We had a terrific alumni dinner and social on homecoming weekend in the fall. This was brand new, a great Politics to Watch in 2023 event in January. And, you know, it's just great tonight to be bringing together so many students, alumni, faculty, staff, and emeriti for another opportunity to connect with each other, to discuss, and to learn. Professor Mark Zacher, I can't see the screen, but I'm hoping you're now looking at his picture. He made a really enormous impact on the UBC Political Science Department. As a beloved colleague, longtime director of the Institute for International Relations, a wonderful mentor and role model for so many students. Mark was a prominent scholar in the field of international relations. And in light of the topic of tonight's lecture, it seems especially poignant to note that probably Mark's most influential work was an article that he wrote about the international norm against using force to change the boundaries between states. This annual lecture was launched in 2013 and made possible by the generosity of key alumni and faculty who came together to honor Mark's legacy as a stellar academic, teacher, and colleague. And the idea behind the series was to create a venue in which every year a leading scholar, often a public scholar or a senior figure in the world of government and foreign policy, would share their insights into key developments going on in the world. This annual lecture, it's meant to give audience a chance to get a better understanding of major events in the international realm through the lens of cutting-edge research in the field. I want to say a huge thank you to those who've made this special lecture possible, both the donors and those who helped organize tonight's event. This includes, first and foremost, Chris Fernandez. Where's Chris? Brent Holmes. Alan Sens. Is Alan here? He's teaching. Really key sort of mastermind behind tonight's event. My colleague Lisa Sundstrom, who you'll be hearing from in a moment, and my colleague Antje Ellerman, who organizes our speaker events. I want to encourage you all to come back to future events on our alumni calendar. So your next opportunity will be the fall 2023 homecoming event, which you'll look out for an announcement of that, and keep your eye open for both our sort of regular set of events and special events as we come up with new ideas, new ways to engage with alumni and a broader UBC political Political Science and IRP. I want to now introduce our moderator for this evening, my terrific colleague, Professor Lisa Sundstrom, who will say a few words about the topic and introduce our visiting speaker.
Thank you very much, Ellen. I'm especially excited to be here this evening. I've admired Kathryn Stoner's work for many years as a fellow scholar in the post-Soviet politics field. We also both have connections to Stanford University, although we have never overlapped in our time there. And Kathryn is Canadian. So, welcome home. It's really an honor to get to know her better during her visit to our department over these next few days. Before introducing Kathryn, I just want to give a little bit of info about the plans for tonight's evening. Following Kathryn's presentation, she'll speak for about 45 minutes. We'll have a brief Q&A period where we'll open up the floor for you to ask her questions. Hang on to your questions and we'll try to get to you after the talk. And we'll have Christine, where she is, wandering around with mics. So when you raise your hand, they can come to you with their mic. After this, we'll have a reception around 7:30, where there will be more food and drinks for you to consume, and an opportunity to mix and mingle with the many alumni who are here, as well as faculty and students, and to connect with Kathryn as well. This is a great opportunity, as Ellen said, for us to connect with a lot of people in the alumni community. So now, let me introduce our visiting Mark Zacher Distinguished Speaker, Kathryn Stoner. Kathryn Stoner is the Mosbacher Director of the Center on Democracy, Development, and the Rule of Law at Stanford University, and a senior fellow at that center, as well as the Center on International Security and Cooperation at Stanford's Freeman Spogli Institute for International Studies. From 2017 to 2021, she served as the Freeman Spogli Institute's Deputy Director. She's a professor of political science by courtesy at Stanford, teaching in the Department of Political Science and in the Program on International Relations, as well as the Ford Dorsey Masters in International Policy Program. She's also a senior fellow by courtesy at the Hoover Institution. Prior to joining Stanford in 2004, she was on the faculty at Princeton University for 9 years, jointly appointed in the Department of Politics and the Princeton School of International and Public Affairs, formerly known as the Wilbur-Wilson School. At Princeton, she received the Ralph O. Glendinning Preceptorship awarded to outstanding junior faculty. She also served as an assistant professor of political science at McGill University. She's held fellowships at Harvard University as well as the Woodrow Wilson Center in Washington, D.C. In addition to many articles and book chapters on contemporary Russia, Kathryn is the author or co-editor of 6 books. The most recent of these are Autocracy and Democracy in the Post-Communist World, which she co-edited with Valerie Bunce and Michael McFaul from Cambridge in 2010. Transitions to Democracy, a Comparative Perspective, written and edited with Michael McFaul from Johns Hopkins Press in 2013. And most recently in 2021 from Oxford University Press, Russia Resurrected, Its Power and Purpose in a New Global Order. Kathryn received her BA and her MA in political science from the University of Toronto and her PhD in government from Harvard University in 1995. In 2016, she was awarded an honorary doctorate from Iliad State University in Tbilisi, Republic of Georgia. So now, I'm very excited to see what kind of a sense she'll give us of why we should all continue to pay close attention to Russia's full-scale war against Ukraine. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Kathryn Stoner.
Thank you very much. I should have told you to lie about when I graduated. But rather than actually saying 1995 out loud like that. But thank you again for having me. There's a little bit of pressure because so many of you are newbies, evidently, poli-sci and IR talks as alums. I'll try and make it entertaining for you and interesting. I want to first of all echo Alan's previous thanks to everyone who made my trip here possible. I really appreciate it, and it's so lovely to be in Vancouver and not in the United States. The most recent president is indicted as of today. So at least that's not happening here. It's an honor to be the Mark Zapker Distinguished Speaker. And I know how inspirational he was to many of his students, also to faculty that have now wonderful jobs around the world. As Alan mentioned, yes, we're going to talk about something that Mark would have been quite interested in, I think, and that is the international norm against using force, a very specific case of breaking that norm. Thank you very much, Alan, for having me. Thanks, Lisa, for the invitation. Thank you again to Chris for organizing my trip as well. And thanks to all of you for coming. Okay, so let's get that horrendous photo of me off there. And let me warn you ahead of time that I'm a wanderer. I'm going to walk around. And some of you will remember Elizabeth Dole when she did this. I will do this. It may scare you, but so here's our agenda for the evening. I'm going to give you some background. This is actually the only way I can see the slides, by the way. I'm going to give you a little bit of background on Ukraine and Russia, not very much, but a little. I'm going to pick up, for those of you who are historians, any historians in the room? Okay, so I'm going to offend you, and I'm going to pick things up pretty late in the game for the Ukrainian-Russian relationship in about 1991. Then we're going to explore some myths that Mr. Putin thinks are truths. We'll look at what Mr. Putin really wants, what Russians really think about this, and why all of this should still matter to you as it slips lower and lower below the fold of the newspaper. And hopefully we will do all of this in 45 minutes or less. Okay, so here is Ukraine, just a few quick facts. Probably know this map in a way that you never pictured you would about 15 months ago. But just some quick refreshers. Before the war, almost 44 million people. Geographically, Ukraine is the second largest country in Europe. The largest is Russia. Some people most don't count Russia as part of Europe. It has, and I'm going to say this repeatedly, been an independent country since December 1991 with the referendum. That Ukraine passed with probably over 90% of the vote, leaving the Soviet Union. Historically, has not always been part of Russia, contrary to Professor Putin's perspective on this. Ukrainian language is not the Russian language. I actually speak Russian reasonably well, and I do not understand Ukrainian. I think I can understand what's going on, but then I realize I have no idea what's going on in a conversation in Ukrainian. So when tensions arise, so I told you that I'll defend some historians because I'm gonna pick it up pretty late, but Russia under Mr. Putin, the Russian opposition began really as early as, and actually earlier than, the 2004 Orange Revolution. But this is when it became very worrisome for Mr. Putin, when Ukrainians began to look west rather than east for their economic and political opportunities. In 2014, we again have a popular uprising, the ouster of Viktor Yanukovych. We'll go through this again. I'm not going to test you at the end. That's the fun thing about being an alumnus. You don't have to worry about that. This was the revolution of dignity, as the Ukrainians call it, the seizure by Russia of the Ukrainian peninsula of Crimea, then an ongoing war from 2014 to 2022. And then, so really what happens in February of 2022 last year is an intensification of this war. All right, so that you probably all knew. But here's the first thing that really gets Vladimir Putin's hackles up about Ukrainian politics, and it's really the Orange Revolution in 2004, when Ukrainians come out en masse to protest what they see as essentially stolen election. That Putin's preferred candidate, Viktor Yanukovych, is supposedly elected in the first round of presidential elections, defeating this guy, who put on your words. And you can see this is the same person, by the way, a handsome man, President Yushchenko, who ran against Yanukovych in the first round. The official results were that he lost. In the second round, we won. Between those rounds, before the first round, he was poisoned, and so he had to go seek treatment outside of Ukraine. Who did it? Gosh, we are not sure. but we are, of course, we did. So in the end, he wins the elections. The opposition unites behind him. But the results initially, as I told you, were not reported for him. In the end, though, Yushchenko is elected president. There was a clear preference, obviously, for Yanukovych, in an attempt even to get rid of Yushchenko. All right, it was a peaceful protest, and that's important to know. Ukrainians did not come out with guns. They were not trying to shoot or kill members of the government. They actually had very peaceful and creative protests. Here are some tents outside in Maidan Square. So why did Mr. Putin care so much about the Orange Revolution? And of course, this wasn't the only so-called color revolution. There was another one in Georgia. And he says it's the threat of NATO membership in former Soviet republics. We're going to come back to that. The threat of European Union membership for former Soviet republics, again, looking west for the future rather than looking to Russia. The loss, he says, of this traditional sphere of influence, we should all have such a thing. And this is really the big reason he doesn't talk about this. The demonstration effect. What if the Russian electorate took to the streets like that? What if they ousted him? And guess what? Russians actually do mobilize. We can get to that later. It is, in a sense, a threat to the stability and survival of Putin's regime because of this demonstration effect. If Ukrainians can do this and get some form of accountable government, if not a fully consolidated democracy, why can't Russians? All right, so we pick things up again. 2004 was the first phase. Phase two is the autumn of 2013, 2014. And there is again a political situation. The irony is after the Orange Revolution, Viktor Yanukovych is in fact legitimately elected president of Ukraine. It is part of his campaign promise that he will sign a draft accession agreement to the European Union on behalf of Ukraine. In November of 2013, he announces he will not actually do this. Instead, he takes a big loan from Russia, and at that point, a lot of people again come back into Maidan Square, and this is called the Revolution of Dignity, and it's peaceful. Hundreds of thousands of protesters, but put some pressure on Yanukovych and says, stand up, don't be so soft. Unfortunately, the Ukrainian security services shoot into the crowd. They kill about 100 people. They're called the Heavenly Hundred now. Yanukovych then begins to negotiate with the protesters and with the parliament. A deal is struck in February of 2014. 2014, but he flees, saying his life is in danger. We then have his removal from power by the Ukrainian parliament. In absentia, he is sentenced to 13 years in jail for treason. He pops up, what do you know, in southern Russia. Shortly thereafter, you might remember this, little green men. They weren't that little, actually. Some of them were pretty tall. And they were really polite, which threw everyone off, because not only did they have no insignia indicating that they were, in fact, Russian soldiers, Mr. Putin denied that they were Russian military at the time. And they were polite and quite well equipped, so and disciplined, which were not things that we were accustomed to seeing with the Russian military. But it turned out it was the Russian military, and they had come out, for the most part, of bases already on the Crimean Peninsula. And they spread out in Crimea and took control. A rump referendum was then held under occupation. And we know, especially when someone voted, over 90% of Crimeans in this referendum allegedly voted to join Russia with Ukraine. So again, why did the regime, notice I keep saying that rather than Russia, there is no Mr. Russia, and I also want you to understand that there's something specific about Putin's regime as opposed to Russia and Russian national interests. So again, why does he care so much about this in Ukraine going on in 2013, 2014? Well, again, it's the contagion effect, the concern that this uprising could happen in Russia, it could happen in Ukraine. This is a regime that looks a lot like his, Yanukovych's, by 2013. It is corrupt. It has mismanaged the economy. Russia does a bit better than that, so then Yanukovych in Ukraine. And there is a de-democratization under Yanukovych. It looks like Russia under Putin in many important ways. But Putin says the big concern here, and why he grabs Crimea, and actually he, for many years, held a conference called Valdai, the Valdai conference, and it's a weird thing, I've been there, and they invite you, I'm not sure if you've been, so the presidential administration invites specialists from around the world on Russia to explain Russia to us. And if you couldn't do it, go on, to be honest, I had to shower off, came back. But at one of these meetings in, I guess it was 2015, fall of 2014, pardon me, he explained to several of us, and Dan Treason in particular wrote a little piece about this, he's got a friend at UCLA, that he was worried, he didn't think it would work, grabbing Crimea. One of the fun things about this conference, and the real reason you go, is Putin comes, so I should have mentioned that. He comes, he's actually shorter than me. He's a little shorter than me, but he is, huh? And look, Michael's not this person. he said, I didn't think it would work. But we came out, and I was worried that maybe we wouldn't have access to the Black Sea Fleet with this crazy new Ukrainian government. And so we came out, and we took it right away. Now, let me just point out, never was it expressed that there was concern about Crimea being part of Ukraine since 1991. This is the first time we hear of it. So how serious a security concern that was, who knows? Of course, Ukraine was being paid, was leasing the bases that Russia has for the Black Sea Fleet in Crimea. This is a source of revenue, an important source of revenue, actually, for a country that was, at that time, the poorest in Europe. What happens thereafter? Well, Russia remains in Ukraine, 2014 through February 23rd, 2022. This is essentially the situation. Russian-backed separatists occupy parts of Luhansk and Donetsk provinces of Ukraine. You probably all know where those are now, but I bet you didn't in 2014, most of you. 14,000 Ukrainians die during this ongoing conflict in the allegedly Russian regions of Ukraine. We'll come Russia absorbs Crimea, hands out passports to residents there, and in the occupied areas of Donbass eventually. They built a bridge, and Mr. Putin was so happy to drive a truck right here across the Kerch Strait. He drives it personally. The Ukrainians blew it up a couple months ago, but it's been quickly rebuilt. And oh, he has a beautiful palace. He loves the Black Sea. He loves it. So he has a palace about, which Alexei Navalny has made a wonderful video about, by the way, to give him on the sea. But allegedly Putin doesn't own it, but yes. So he absorbs Crimea, hands out passports, builds the bridge, works on Nord Stream 2, the pipeline. Nord Stream 1 already exists as a gas pipeline, in order to route gas from Russia to Europe away from Ukraine. Countries pay for transit fees if pipelines go across their territory. So the reason we in the United States and Canada oppose the construction of Nord Stream 2 is it would deprive Ukraine of those rights. So between 2014 and 2022, trying to starve Ukraine economically, trying to sabotage the Ukrainian economy. This is just one example, but there are many, many others. There are there is a peace accord process between 2014 and 2022 that just fails, basically, partly because Russia just won't respect the border between Ukraine and Russia. Minsk 1 and 2, they're never fully implemented. Putin insists that the Russian tanks that we can see by satellite going into these regions in Ukraine are just soldiers on vacation. And it's their own time, and they vacation in their tanks. And they're trapped. And if they bring stuff, well, that's really up to them, isn't it? They're patriots. I'm not even making this up. Okay. Why did Putin grab Crimea again? Well, here are some scenes from Yanukovych's palace in Ukraine. Yanukovych, the former president, who was ousted in February 2014. This is a pirate ship that he had built. It's a replica. It's not really a pirate ship. It's a restaurant for him and his family and visitors. This is his palace as well. Here in the bottom is dacha. And there were swans. And shortly after the Revolution of Dignity, as it's called in Ukraine in 2014, you could see Ukrainians were allowed to walk in and discover this. And you know, it was Trumpy, frankly, golden toilet seats, that kind of thing. But what was clear was he was stealing from this, right? This corruption went all the way to the top here, and these were just symbols of it. So why did Putin then take this huge risk in grabbing Ukraine? It causes another large frozen conflict in the former Soviet states. We have one in Georgia. In 2008, Russia also seized two provinces there. They occupy them, the Republic of Georgia, that is. Moldova and the Transnistria region also. Ostensibly, this is all to liberate and defend the Russian diaspora that live in these places. But in fact, it's a little more complicated than that. It's basically to destabilize these countries. These are not regions that are just solely, exclusively Russian ethnically. You can't join the European Union if there's an ethnic conflict, right? So notice where they have done this. Georgia aspiring to EU membership, and Ukraine in particular. There also in 2014 was a distraction from Putin's own political problems, and we'll look at his popularity ratings in a few minutes. So there is this, some of you may have seen, ever seen the movie Wag the Dog? Yes, so the Wag the Dog scenario. I don't put much stock in that, honestly. Real fear of NATO in the Black Sea. I'll show you why I don't think that's the case either. And then this new narrative that Putin has come up with, which is Ukraine is at the heart of Russian identity. It is where in 989 AD, Prince Vladimir took on Orthodoxy. And an interesting guy, he auditioned Islam, he auditioned the Greek Orthodox, he auditioned Christianity, and and Roman Catholicism, and he chose Greek Orthodox, which eventually becomes Russian, and he's been a patron of peace too. So there's a certain irony in Putin turning to religion and Russian Orthodoxy to justify this. And certainly in 2000, we didn't talk about how religious he is. And in 2023, we were seeing a different form of Putin than we have seen up until about 2020. Because, you know, he's got at least six children from three different women. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's just that you're going to be the leader of a conservative world. There's a certain irony in that. All right. Okay. So, after 2014, too, there's an opportunity for Putin. And so he is able to keep Ukraine somewhat destabilized, right? And so this is Petro Poroshenko, who is a chocolate, well, he is, he's still alive, chocolate magnate, and was Ukraine's president, legitimately elected from 2014 to 2019. He actually undertook a lot of reform in those 5 years when he was president. This is after the Revolution of Dignity. He wasn't able to settle the conflict in Donbass, however, with Russia. Ukraine struggled with corruption, although I think that this is actually yet another problem Putin has solved for Ukraine. There's far less corruption now than before. He managed to increase foreign investment, tries to free Ukraine from its reliance on Russian energy, which Russia uses as a weapon against not just Ukraine, but many other former Soviet states as well. He did actually have some success, nonetheless, as in terms of governance in Ukraine. Nonetheless, he is defeated rather resoundingly by this guy. Bet you know who this is, right? Bet you didn't know who he was 2 years ago. But you know who he is now, our hero, right? In the West, elected in April 2019, 73% of the vote. He comes in on an anti-corruption platform. Has anyone seen his show? Have you seen it? Lisa's seen it? Yes. It's fabulous, right? It's called Servant of the People, and it's on Netflix. I think it's still on Netflix. And there are subtitles. It's very, very funny. Even if you know nothing about Ukraine and thought of, and you're gonna know so much in the next, you know, by the time we're done tonight. It's really funny. It is about a teacher, since you haven't seen it, I'll tell you. It's about this guy who is a high school teacher, and his, I think it's roughly the 10th grade class that witnesses him ranting to a colleague about how, you know, corruptly the school is run. It goes viral on YouTube. And then his students register him for the presidential election in Ukraine, and he wins. So he's kind of an accidental president. The show is called Servant of the People. His political party is called Servant of the People. So he tries to clean up corruption. Anyway, it's quite a big show. He's almost like the Tom Hanks, I would say, of the Russian-speaking world, in a lot of romantic comedies as well, a professional comedian, but also a businessman. I think a lot of the narrative out of Russia was he's a lightweight, he's a comedian, he's an actor, he's not serious, but they forget that actually ran a production company and is a business person as well. He grew up, as you probably know, as a Russian speaker in the former Soviet countries that were formerly Soviet republics. Often the Jewish is still regarded as an ethnicity or nationality, so he is Jewish. Yet Putin calls him a Nazi, which is a hard thing. He's fluent in Ukrainian and English, and of course Russian too. He has a law degree as well. He is known to Russian TV watchers. Right? They saw him on television. think this ran 8 seasons. Maybe I'm maybe overestimating that. He runs in 2019 and wins the election, as I said, with 73% of the vote on an anti-corruption platform, just like his character, the Servant of the People. His party is called Servant of the People. And he is now, of course, a wartime president. Oh, I don't know how this slipped, but that is me right there. Yes, so full disclosure, I'm a bit of a fan. As you can see, he did come and visit us at Stanford in August, actually, of just the end of August, early September of 2021. So we were able to spend some time with him then. And you can see already how much older it looks. Older he looks. All right, I promised that we would get into part two now, which is some myths about this conflict between Ukraine and Russia. Here's one that Mr. Putin brings up a lot, and I think is a popular misconception about Ukraine, that it is divided between the Russian-speaking East and the Ukrainian-speaking nationalist West. Therefore, Russia is intervening to these people in the East who are Russian speakers from these Nazi nationalists who want to take away their culture, take away their language. Again, certain irony in that, because what is Russia doing right now in those very regions, taking away the culture and language of Ukrainians, ethnic Ukrainians in this area. So here's the reality. Ukraine was divided in some ways for a period, yes. It was true in 2004, electorally. Here are the election results. Here's Yanukovych, Party of Regions, and you can see most of his vote did come from here. Yushchenko's, most of his came from the rest of the country. But look at 2019 and the vote for Zelensky. Look at that. Yeah, over 70% of vote in the very regions that Putin is claiming wanted to leave, don't believe in a united Ukraine. So empirically, this is wrong. And by the way, if you go back and look in 1991, you'll see that it was also not divided along these ethnic lines, right? I put in this in case you want to look up the data. Myth two, basically then, if you don't believe that it's divided, basically Ukraine is Russia and Russia, right? It's the same language. Well, I already assured you, believe me, it is not. And this is a language map of Ukraine. It's actually kind of old, but it's about 10 years old here. But you can see, okay, this is where the first language is at home, is Russian, but that doesn't mean it's the exclusive language, or that Russian isn't spoken in this part, or that Ukrainian isn't spoken in this part, it is. And there are some other languages here too. If you're English-Canadian, okay, so here's the flawed logic. You speak English, I'm an English-Canadian, it's already been confessed to you that I am in fact Canadian, from Sudbury, Ontario, anyone else? No, okay, that always happens. You speak English, but do you want to be rescued by English? Here in Canada, you want England to come in and take us back over. Right, okay, so imagine Russian speakers, Zelensky himself, the president of Ukraine, feel the same way, right? Just because you speak the language doesn't mean that there's some kind of ethnic affinity, save us, save us. In fact, they don't want to necessarily be saved, and there are some people who do want to fight, but you know, there are people in the United States who want to fight too. But this is often overstated, how divided Ukraine is. Ukraine is an independent country. It has been since 1991. Boris Yeltsin, in fact, Russia's first elected president, signed the Budapest Memorandum in 1994, guaranteeing Ukrainian sovereignty and security backed by the United States and the United Kingdom. And so if you're wondering why is the United States involved, I know because, again, I'm Canadian. They're so obnoxious. They are everywhere. They think everything is their business. Am I right? I know. Well, we actually signed something making this our business, and it was tied to nuclear weapons. So it guaranteed Ukrainian sovereignty. We backed its security with in exchange for legacy nuclear weapons from the Soviet period moving from Ukraine into Russia. And so that's actually why we're there. That's one reason. But we have an obligation to be it. Myth number three. It's our fault. NATO expanded, and this has provoked Putin. And he is behaving in the way that any leader of Russia would behave. And it's all our fault. I'm not even going to name who perpetrates this absurdity, but I did debate him at APSA, American Political Science Association. It's a guy in Chicago who says this, and this is a Kremlin line. NATO expansion has provoked Russia. This is a defensive war in Ukraine that any Russian leader would wage. Doesn't matter that Putin is an oppressive autocrat to his own people and has become aggressive abroad, not just in Ukraine, but elsewhere. This is in my book from 2021 that documents this. Another one is Gorbachev was promised in 1989 that NATO would not expand one inch beyond a united Germany's borders. Okay, no, he wasn't. There's a wonderful new book that came out last year by Mary Sorati, who's a historian at Johns Hopkins, called Not One Inch. And it actually goes back into both the Soviet archives and US archives. And it is true that Jim Baker, who was Ronald Reagan, pardon me, George W. Secretary of State, talked to Gorbachev in 1990 about German reunification and said, hey, if you got your troops out of East Germany, because remember the Berlin Wall falls in 1989, Germany wants to quickly reunify East and West Germany. If you get your troops quickly out of East Germany, then, you know, because Germany was already a member of NATO, what about if we guaranteed NATO couldn't expand, or wouldn't expand beyond German borders? Okay, he goes back to Washington and he says to Brent Scowcroft and George W. Bush, or H.W., sorry, the father, what about this? I said this to Gorbachev. And they're both outraged at this and say, are you nuts? And George Shultz also says this, are you nuts? No, we're not going to do that. NATO, the expansion of NATO, and the ability for any country to join is in the NATO original founding treaty signed in 1949. So it isn't up to the United States alone, but nothing is ever signed. Nothing is ever articulated beyond that between the United States and the Soviet Union, and Gorbachev himself at the time said no such statement is actually made by the president. There was nothing signed. What Putin, who mentions this all the time, doesn't mention is that Budapest memorandum that he signed, that Yeltsin signed in 1994 about guaranteeing Ukrainian sovereignty. All right, another thing about NATO expansion. So, as I mentioned, Budapest agreement. Second, NATO has not expanded to Russia's borders since 2004. So 10 years before he seizes Crimea, was the last time NATO expanded. It was the Baltic Republics, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. There was no promise of expansion, as I made, to Gorbachev or Yeltsin. There wouldn't be expansion. The states that have joined NATO since 2004 includes most recently North Macedonia. Do you know where that is? Okay, I'm in Canada, of course. Okay, so most Americans don't know where it is, and let me assure you, most American parents do not want their soldier kids fighting for North Macedonia. So if anything, this expansion has weakened the Article 5 guarantee in NATO, but an attack on one is an attack on all, right? That implies that we'll go to war for North Macedonia. I think Canada might not go to war for North Macedonia either, but there's probably a North Macedonian community here, so there'd be more pressure than the United States to do that. All right, so again, Putin points to 2008, when George Bush, in the Bucharest Memorandum, in the NATO meeting, says, someday, Ukraine and Georgia will join NATO. But purposely, this is vague. This is not an accession agreement for Georgia and Ukraine, because Angela Merkel, and at the time, the President of France, will not risk provoking Russia by guaranteeing or inviting Ukraine to join NATO. Irony, therefore, is Ukraine was not about to join NATO, it's not on track to join NATO in 2022 because of this, the worry about provoking Russia. Well, it turns out it didn't need to be a member of NATO to provoke Russia. It was going to happen anyway. Okay, the facts on NATO expansion: Ukraine's not a member. Its membership is not even in the planning stage. It wasn't, at least, until the beginning of the war. Here, there are no NATO-US missiles in Ukraine. That's another thing that Russian political actors bring up. Here are the only two anti-missile systems in Poland and Romania. They've both been members of NATO since 1997. They are defensive in capability. They are aimed at Iran. NATO's open door policy, as I mentioned, been in place since 1949 in the founding treaty. It is not new. Ukraine is sovereign and independent. It can do what it wants. Ukraine will also offer, in order to try and prevent this re-invasion in February of last year, actually offered in December of 2021 to be neutral, to never join NATO. It wasn't enough. Russia invaded it. This isn't about NATO expansion. That's not the problem. It's about the demonstration effect, in particular. What does Putin say he wants by invading Ukraine? Well, he has said all of these things. Neutrality? No, I just told you, they offered it. Not enough. NATO off Russian borders. So he wants to kick out, basically, the Baltic republics, because those are the only three NATO states. But he actually says he wants to go back to pre-1994 NATO expansion. He wants no new NATO members to breach the treaty. A new European security architecture, and apparently what he means by that is great powers cutting out spheres of influence, like the 19th century. Now, the problem with that is when great powers fought over or had spheres of influence carved out around the world, we have war, almost constant war in Europe. And that, of course, bled around the world to European colonies and France. He wants no U.S. missiles or troops in Europe. So we had actually very few U.S. troops in Europe. And NATO had very few troops in Poland and Romania before 2014. Now there are more than there have been in the post-war period because of his invasion, first in 2014 and now in 2022. But there are no NATO troops inside Ukraine. Okay. What has Russia done? In the last year, four provinces of Ukraine were declared part of Russia by the Russian government, and this is in addition to the annexation of Crimea. Now they're supposedly rebuilding within those provinces. People in these regions have been given Russian citizenship, whether they want it or not. Children, as you probably know, when their parents couldn't be found, and even when they could, there's an estimate that about 300,000 or 400,000 children may have been removed from this area. And all of this is, of course, in violation of international law. This is why Putin was just indicted by the International Criminal Court for crimes against humanity. Here's the imaginary annexation of four regions of Russia on September 30th, 2022. There's Putin with the, you can see his stature in this line here. Here, 40 years. You can see him here with the rump governors of these regions. Never mind that they actually don't control these regions, not all of them, and not all of them completely. It's about 15-17% of Ukrainian territory. It's the largest land grab in Europe since World War II. He thinks or says that there, it was a historic choice that these four regions opted to join Russia in, a referendum. It's got to look right, just like it did in Crimea, a referendum. Held in places like Mariupol that Russia bombed the HE double hockey sticks at. In Canada, so I'm going to get that. I'll show you the new map of Russia that is up now in government offices. Look at that. They've just taken these regions, and this is what is now being taught to Russian children. Problem is this, they don't control all of those regions. Yet, see, you can see it in particular here at Kherson. Sorry. You can see that the Ukrainians are pushing back. So this is kind of an interesting map. It is updated every day by the ISW. You can find it online. Russia does not occupy all of these territories. This is what this is as of last week. And the dark lines are what they occupied before. 2022. This is what they have taken now. Here, of course, Mariupol is there. All right. So, what's gone wrong for Russia in Ukraine? Why are they doing so badly? Well, I read, as Lisa mentioned, I wrote a book last year called Russia Resurrected, which is about ways in which Russia has new power tools that are not traditional power tools, but it also looks at their hard power, their military capacity. First of all, a couple of things. It's really hard to take a big country. The United States tried to do it in Iraq, not terribly successful. Tried to do it in Afghanistan, not terribly successful. The United States is by far and away the most powerful military in the world by tenfold over the Russian military. The Russian military, compared to the Ukrainian military, probably should have done better. That it did. One of the reasons for its performance is, first of all, intelligence failures in the FSB and a particular division of the FSB that actually has an international component that assured Putin of three things. One, Zelensky is weak, and actually his opinion or approval rating had dropped below 40% before the invasion. He will flee as soon as we invade. The Ukrainian military is not terribly capable, judging from the performance in 2014 when we took Crimea. And if we tell them to, they'll put down their weapons. And three, the Ukrainian people want to be liberated by Russia. And they will welcome us with bouquets of flowers as we head towards Kyiv. So you might recall that the U.S., we were assured by Don Rumsfeld that the United States, when we went in with our coalition partners, would be greeted by Iraqis with rose petals in American tanks. So there's confirmation bias here, right? I mean, we've done similar things. It's even worse in conditions of autocracy like Putin's, which is hardened over time. People are afraid to bring this confirming. It's not just being selected. It's also seeing what you want to see, for sure, but it's also certain fear bring this confirming evidence. There's a lack of competence in the military, but not of capability. They have the weapons to annihilate Ukraine. Fortunately, they're not using them, and the ones that they've used, they're actually kind of wasting some of the capacity that they have on silly things that are not military targets. We We also see a lot of corruption in the Russian military, and we saw that before the in the 1 or 2 or 3 days before the military actually invaded Ukraine, with commanders selling off equipment. So this is typical again of Russian bureaucracies, not all of them, but of large Russian bureaucracies as well. And so here's the consequence of that. And of course, Ukrainians are fighting for their lives. They're fighting for their country, so they're very committed to fighting back, including civilians. And guess what? They don't want to be liberated by Russians. Now, there are a few that do, but the vast majority, obviously, does not. The military of 2014 is not the Ukrainian military of 2022, and that was, again, for intelligence. Unexpected is that the Western alliance has held, has continued to supply the Ukrainian military with equipment and training. And also, this is the most comprehensive sanctions regime that has ever been implemented on an economy this size or at all. In Russia itself, somewhere in between, and I apologize for this being such a broad estimate, but we don't exactly know how many have gone out and come back in, between 500,000 and a million people in the last 13 months have left Russia. Many of them are very highly trained in the IT sectors, and so it's quite possible they're not coming back. A lot of young men in particular. This exacerbates Russia's own demographic problems. And Putin is now using fear far more than just control over information to keep Russian citizens complacent and compliant. So Russian autocracy has grown harder. So what do Russians think about the war? It's probably something you don't hear as much about. I watch this all the time and I keep hoping the numbers will change. But there's some context to this. So you probably can't see it terribly well, but let me tell you what it is. So this is Putin's approval rating from August 1999, when he first becomes prime minister of Russia, and then he becomes president, acting president first on January 1st of 2000, and then he's elected. So you can see people don't really know who he is, but agree is this line up here, the black line. Disagree is down here. The question is, do you approve the activities of Vladimir Putin as the president, parenthetically prime minister, because he's been prime minister twice, he's been prime minister again, 2008, 2012, yes or no? Here's last month. We don't have this month's figures out yet. 83% approval. As you can see, COVID, not looking good. Here's the seizure of Crimea. That's the white dog scenario. Goes up really high, blah, 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 blah. Recession, COVID. And then war, so maybe wipe it off, not. Why is this so high? And this is where you can find it, by the way. This is the only remaining sort of independent, still independent. They have to declare themselves a foreign agent in all of their communications, the Levada Center. Here is breaking down over time, you can see that this is asking your support for the military forces. So this is not Putin himself. Support for the Russian armed forces in Ukraine remains high. 42% are saying they definitely support. That's down here. And that most recent numbers that they're posting are November 2022. 20% clearly, definitely against here, these two polls. There's significant variation by age. Older people, 40 to 54 and 55 and older in particular, 75% say that they support the military. The lowest is younger people, 18 to 24. There it's 62% of them expressing support for the military. These are the people who have to fight. They're also lowest in terms of their support. Why is support still so high? Well, hopefully some of these pictures disrupt your impression of Russians, okay? I'm Russian that says I'm against the war. This is someone being hauled off in just outside Red Square, protesting the war, and it says no war. This can get you 3 years in prison and a 14,000 ruble fine, which is about 2 months' salary. So there is some genuine support, to be sure, of both of Putin and of the war, but it's hard to protest in Russia today. There were initially protests in Russia of tens of thousands of people, and about 14,000 were arrested. I personally have about 4 friends in jail. 2 of them just got 9-year sentences. There was a man out in Eastern Russia who was in the paper recently because his daughter made a picture, drawing, she's 12, in school that said, "No war and I'm against the war." Her teacher reported this picture to the local authorities. The local authorities then looked at her father's social media feed. He's a single father. It turned out he had had some posts that were anti-war. It was against the law in Russia now to say anything that is counter to the official narrative on the Department of Defense's, the Ministry of Defense's website about the war and its official version of events. He was investigated, charged. He was about to go to jail for, I think, a 3-year sentence. And then he disappeared. He popped up in Belarus. They found him and things like that. 12 years old, made a picture. And that's what happened to her dad. He's a criminal. So it's hard to protest in Russia right now. Other measures give a slightly different view, and I'm almost finished here, of attitudes inside Russia. So, you know, what would you do if somebody comes to your door, and these are in-person surveys, interviews. Someone comes to your door, you don't know them, knock on the door, and they say, "Hey, Alan, I'm Kathryn from the Levada Center. I'd like to interview you about your opinions toward the president of Russia and your support for the Russian military." Now, I'm guessing Alan, because he is a political scientist, he's going to answer my questions, but what would most of us do? Would you open the door? Right, okay, and you live in a democracy. So if you didn't live in a democracy, you probably might not, right? So we're not being given any more numbers of refusals. Not refuse to answer the questions, refusing the survey, right? Okay, so then I ask Alan, what's your response to these questions? What's the path of least resistance? Alan, do you like Alan, do you support Vladimir Putin? You want to keep your job? All right, yeah, sure, of course. Right, of course, it's easiest to say yes, of course, right? Even if you don't, just say you do. That's the easiest thing. So that hopefully makes you see the people who said that they don't in a slightly different view, right? You don't know what's going to happen. So we look at other things. Let's look at mood, for example. Now, mood in hope for the future in September 2022, this is 7 months into the war, and this is before the big mobilization. There's about to be another one of about 400,000 men. Those professing positive feelings, just like, "I feel good," 52%, 47% negative feelings. The important thing is that is the lowest in 23 years since they started. 53% of Russians in November 2022 favored talks to end the conflict. So maybe that's a better measure of support. But there's still a few signs of instability within Russia itself. Happy to talk about this. Okay, here we are. Why should this still matter? Well, here's what this war has done to Ukraine. Tomorrow I'm going to give a talk about what it's done to Russia, to the political scientists. Here are the effects on Ukraine and Ukrainians. And by the way, these are effects on Europe as well. Europe is our closest ally, or a set of allies, European Union. 8,157,230 refugees as of last week across Europe. This is an underestimate for sure. Almost 8,300 dead civilians since February 2022. 5,914,000 internally displaced people. This is a country of about 44 million. So add that up. The World Bank last week estimated $411 billion U.S. would be the cost to rebuild Ukraine if the war ended now, and it's not going to. That's 2.5 times more than its 2022 gross domestic product. So why should you still care? That's why maybe Europe should still care. Well, again, because this is the Zachar lecture, right? And the norm of norm of respecting the sovereignty of other countries. This is a war of choice. This was not a war of necessity. There was no imminent danger to Russia. Ukraine was not about to join NATO. NATO was not poised in the Black Sea to take Crimea back. And it was not inevitable. It isn't something every Russian leader would do. We can talk about that, the course of change in Russia over 23 years. Second reason we really care about this, there's a possibility of full-scale war in Europe right now, for the first time since the end of World War II. That war, World War II, had global reach. That's the word world in war, right? You're already feeling probably the economic effects here in Canada with inflation, with high oil prices, high cost of food, maybe shortages. In the global south, they're feeling it even more because Ukraine and Russia are, of course, big meat producers. Russia, the largest exporter of wheat in the world, eclipsing even Canada here. And fertilizer. So this affects the food chain and other countries in the south. I was on the phone with some Brazilians last week. They're very dependent on Russian fertilizer, for example, and they can't get it. Fourth, if Russia under Putin is permitted to take Ukraine and just say, okay, you know what? Make a deal. Why not keep going? Why not take Moldova? Why not keep going maybe to Poland or up to the Baltics? They're basically already taking Belarus as well. And then fifth, there is now a non-zero possibility of nuclear weapons being used in war. Happy to talk more about the statements about this, and it's not a high possibility, but it's possible. Suspended the new Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty just last month, and just announced a few days ago that they are going to move tactical nuclear weapons back into Belarus after taking them out after the collapse of the Soviet Union. So lots of reasons to care. This is just a short list. And Lisa, I'll stop there. I did feel my buzzer go off.